In the nation-defining quest to reach the moon, America's astronauts had one of the most dangerous jobs in human history. In 1967, three astronauts would find out just how deadly it could be. This is the dark story of the Apollo 1 disaster. As always, viewer discretion is advised. In October 1957, the Soviet Union launched the very first satellite into space. Soon after, it was widely reported that the Soviet Union was producing ICBM missiles at an astonishing rate, far surpassing US efforts. The American public demanded a response to this perceived threat. Seizing the opportunity, John F. Kennedy, in his 1960 bid for the White House, accused the Eisenhower administration of being weak on defense. But the Soviet Union's triumphs were unrelentless. On April 12, 1961, they awed the world again, launching the cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin into orbit around Earth, the first man in space. This news devastated the American public. It was becoming clear that the Russians were well ahead in the space race. Having narrowly won the election, President Kennedy pledged a massive expansion of NASA's budget, and in May 1961, publicly announced that America would go to the moon before the end of the decade. Following on from the smaller-scale Mercury and Gemini missions, the Apollo space program set out to achieve a goal so ambitious and remarkable, the excitement could be felt in every household across America. Men would walk on the moon within just 10 years. Whole new rockets and spacecraft were put into development at a breakneck pace, and missions to incrementally test the new craft and systems were planned. Apollo 1 was to be the first manned mission of the newly conceived program. The mission involved launching the Command and Service Module, or CSM, on the newly upgraded Saturn 1B rocket into orbit with a crew of three men. During the two-week journey, they would assess the spacecraft systems as well as the control and ground-based tracking capabilities. Virgil Gus Grissom was selected to command the mission. A highly educated and well-liked commander, Grissom didn't shy away from criticizing the technical flaws in the spacecraft, earning him the nickname Gruff Gus. Grissom, a seasoned astronaut, had already completed two spaceflights in the Mercury and Gemini space programs. One of the flights landed in the Atlantic Ocean, and Grissom was nearly drowned when the exit hatch unexpectedly blew off the crafts and it began to sink. To prevent further accidents, NASA removed the explosive bolts on the exit hatch, but this decision would come back to haunt them. Two other crewmen were selected for the Apollo 1 mission. Edward White, the first American to complete a spacewalk, was an accomplished athlete and deeply religious man. The last man, Roger Chaffee, was an experienced Navy pilot and became the youngest American astronaut to be selected for a mission at only 30 years old. Enthusiastic and demonstrating a high competence and desire to be selected for the mission, Chaffee was brought in at a late stage to replace another astronaut who had been injured during training. In August 1966, the crew began to express concerns over the presence of flammable materials in their spacecraft, CSM-012. The crew jokingly took a photograph of themselves praying and sent the picture to the man responsible for the design and construction of the spacecraft, Joe Shea, with the inscription, "It isn't that we don't trust you, Joe, but this time we've decided to go over your head." Hundreds of modifications were made to the capsule leading up to the launch date. After the hardware problems had been fixed, subsequent altitude tests demonstrated that the craft was in a satisfactory condition. However, it had not been properly inspected and still contained numerous flammable materials. The backup crew commander, Walter Shearer, who participated in testing the CSM, was later quoted as saying, "There's nothing wrong with this ship that I can point to, but it just makes me uncomfortable. Something about it just doesn't ring right." By this time, NASA was gripped with what was termed go fever, imparting enormous pressure on the engineers and astronauts to launch at any cost. The eyes of the world were watching them. On January 27, 1967, a plugs-out test was planned that would test the craft running on its own power while attached to its Saturn rocket and simulate a launch countdown. Just 5 days prior to the test, Grissom hung a lemon on the simulator, expressing his feelings about its quality. The craft was scheduled for a February 21 launch, and the plugs-out test was expected to be low risk as it would not involve any fuel. The day was to be like many before. The families of the astronauts would not have known about the dangers of the coming test. In an interview in 1966, Grissom was asked if he feared something going wrong with the upcoming mission. He responded, "You have to put that out of your mind. There's always a possibility that you can have a catastrophic failure." At 1 p.m, Grissom, Chaffee and White entered the command module wearing flight suits and strapped into their seats. The craft was pressurized above regular atmospheric levels and pure oxygen was pumped into the CSM. By 6:30 p.m., the crew were preparing for their simulated launch when things went suddenly and horrifically wrong. Wiring inside one of the control systems was overloaded by a momentary spike in voltage. Over video monitors, mission observers saw flames begin to spread in the capsule and saw White reach out for the inner hatch handle, attempting to open the door. In the event of an emergency, the escape procedure was expected to take up to 90 seconds, but within just 30, the heat of the fire began to rapidly increase the internal pressure. The hull began to rupture, spewing out smoke and flames. The ground crew rushed to assist, but were forced back due to ineffective gas masks and the heat of the inferno. As the fire burned, it was feared that it would trigger an ignition of the Saturn 1B's fuel, which would cause a devastating explosion that would destroy the launch pad and kill everyone in the vicinity. It took 5 long minutes to bring the fire under control. Finally, rescuers were able to open the outer and then inner hatch of the burned capsule. There, they discovered the blackened bodies of the 3 astronauts. Grissom and White were found on the floor, the position of their bodies signaling that they were attempting to open the hatch when they died. Chaffee was still strapped to his seat, following procedure to maintain communication with the ground crew. The bodies were blackened and burned severely. It was initially difficult to distinguish between the bodies of Grissom and White. Immediately following the fire, a NASA investigation was commissioned to determine the cause and responsibility for the accident. It was found that all 3 men died of carbon monoxide inhalation, as the fire had melted their breathing tubes, exposing them to lethal gases. All 3 men left behind wives and young children. When Betty Grissom, Gus's wife, was informed of her husband's death, she said that she had already died 1,000 deaths being married to an astronaut. The Accident Review Committee found several major factors that led to the disaster. Faulty wiring paired with combustible coolant was the primary ignition source. As the fire burned faster, the presence of flammable materials within the cabin fanned the flames. The already elevated pressure was increased, making the inward swinging hatch impossible to open. The prime contractor, North American Aviation, responsible for the design of the hatch, had previously requested that explosive bolts be used instead, allowing the door to be quickly jettisoned if necessary. NASA had denied this request, as the Mercury accident involving Gus Grissom had shown the system to be unreliable in its current state. The high oxygen environment was also a factor, chosen due to the simplicity of pressurizing the cabin. NASA had experienced several accidents with pure oxygen environments, but continued to use this method. Valentin Bondarenko, a Soviet cosmonaut, was killed in similar circumstances in 1961, but due to the secrecy of the Soviet space program, his death was never made public. On their own, these flaws may not have proven deadly, but when combined, resulted in a catastrophic failure. In the aftermath, North American Aviation was found to be partly at fault for the accident, and the chief engineer was fired in disgrace. But it was also the culture of NASA at the time to take shortcuts, pushing forward against their better judgment. Gene Kranz, a chief flight director, said after the event, "We are the cause. We were not ready. We did not do our job. We were rolling the dice, hoping that things would come together by launch day, when in our hearts we knew it would take a miracle." Joe Scheer, the man responsible for the spacecraft, was accused of criminal negligence by members of the investigation committee and suffered a nervous breakdown, leaving NASA shortly after. Having failed to report problems with the program, the investigation found NASA to be grossly negligent and ultimately responsible for the astronauts' deaths. The program was halted as redesigns were made to the CSM, including redesigning the capsule hatches and removing all flammable materials from inside future craft. It would be another 18 months before American astronauts would board an Apollo spacecraft. The accident forced NASA to pause and rethink many elements of the space program. Paradoxically, this slowing down is what allowed the Apollo space program to pull ahead in the race, as the emphasis shifted from launching at any cost to prioritizing safety and reliability. The first phase of the Apollo space program paved the way for the successful mission of Apollo 11, reaching the final frontier of men walking on the moon in 1969. The deaths of Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Roger Chaffee were not in vain. Thanks for watching, guys. I have another video on Soviet space disasters linked on the screen, so if you're interested in finding out about some of the failures of the Soviet space program, check that one out. If you enjoyed this video, please leave a like and a comment, and I'll see you next time.